is CNN.
Welcome to a special 10th anniversary edition of Larry King Live. Tonight.
Over the years, her roles have entertained us. Amused us.
One night you're going to be sitting around here laughing and kidding just like that, and there's going to be a knock on the door. You see? And there will be Ziegfeld.
But haven't they also taught us something about what she believes? And about what women can do. About taking care of one another.
Let's go to the movies.
Earlier this year, she offered a more traditional lesson at a most traditional forum, lecturing students at Harvard University.
Until women are treated equally with men, until gays and minorities are not discriminated against, and until children have their full rights, artists must continue to speak out. I will be one of them. Sorry, Rush, Newt, Jesse. The artist, the citizen, is here to stay.
Good evening from New York. Welcome to this special edition of Larry King Live. Our guest for the full hour is the brilliant Barbra Streisand, coming off a successful tour, major television show, new films, lots to talk about. One thing before we begin, we're going to wear Save These Children ties, Save the Children ties, all this month of June, saluting this wonderful organization. These children design all these ties. We'll be letting you know where you can get them. We began this program with the standing ovation at Harvard and your closing remarks. And one, let's trace back a little. First, why did you agree to speak there? How did that come about?
They asked me.
But knowing you, we asked you. How many times did we ask you?
Yeah, I know. That's
20
true.
Times we asked.
Well, I was supposed to do the Harvard speech in April before my tour started in London. And I just thought that was interesting because I've always had strong feelings about the artist as citizen, the artist constantly being denigrated in society. I heard an interesting story the other day about Molière. On his deathbed, they wouldn't give him his last rites unless he denounced his profession. So this thing goes back a long way, you know?
You're kidding.
No, I'm not kidding.
So did you agree to speak with trepidation with forthrightness?
With both.
Knowing you, that's true.
Yeah, with both. But I was so consumed with the rehearsals for my show that I had to cancel it. So I thought maybe they'd let me off the hook after the tour. But they said, no, we still would like you to come and speak. And so that's why I did it this last February.
Can you tell us why so public a person is so stage frightened or nervous?
First of all, I think I'm like I would say 95% of the population who would have stage fright standing up to speak publicly. You know, I'm like everybody else.
Right. Most people are afraid of that.
Right. I mean, I was at a party recently, an engagement party for a friend of mine. 40 women and everybody that they knew and loved, and the girl stood up and said, I'm so scared standing up here speaking. There were no cameras. There were no lights. There were no reporters, right?
Right.
And she was scared. So I got this honorary degree a couple of weeks ago at Brandeis. I had to say nothing. Just all I had to do was get this sort of band over my head.
You were not
the
speaker.
I was not the speaker. And I was totally frightened.
Of what?
You see, certain things are inexplainable. They're irrational. And
on stage before thousands?
Well, that took me 27 years to go back and do that, you know. I mean, the last tour I had was when I was pregnant with my son Jason, 1966.
Well, it was on this program. I said, why don't you tour again? You said, I'm not going to tour.
Well, I said, didn't I say I was thinking about it?
You were thinking, I'll think about it, but I'm not really.
Well, I like to conquer my fears. And it's interesting because I was able to do it with the tour. And then after the tour, this sort of post-performance stress set in. And I was like, I did that, and I got frightened again. Now, I'm frightened when I sing, which is in my milieu. I mean, I know I sort of do that well. Well, you know what I mean. So to speak about
my... You mean you're frightened about, will I do well? Will I sing well?
I got past that. In other words, what I got past was looking for perfection. I was able to say, no, this is in the moment, this is spontaneous, and this is as good as I can do right now, and it'll have to be good enough, and I am good enough.
So you're at that with
that.
So
I was, I was, I got past a lot of my fears, but...
Let's go back. Mm-hmm. Brooklyn, where you grew up. Mm-hmm. Very special place. I grew up there, so we have a lot in mm-hmm. common. You went to a great high school, Erez. What kind mm-hmm. of kid were you? What was little Barbara like?
I was very rebellious. I remember I had the chicken...
I'm shocked.
I had the chicken pox, I remember, and I climbed out. I got dressed, climbed out of the window, and went out to play. No, the chicken pox didn't stop me, you know. I was always asking a lot of questions, which I still do today, because I think of myself as a perpetual student, you know.
Were you a good student?
Yeah, I was a very good student.
Studious?
Yeah, I was an honor student, but I was kind of, how would you say this? I dressed peculiarly, you know, I hung around with the smart kids who wore Oxfords and glasses, right? But
you were not an Oxford.
But I didn't look that way, you know. I wore blue eyeshadow, and I remember when I got my medal for having the highest mark in the Spanish class, my teacher, Mrs. Tomas, who spoke with a lisp and spoke, you know, Castilian Spanish, she made a remark about, you know, you don't have to wear blue eyeshadow to get the Spanish medal. So it was incongruous.
So you were different. You felt different.
I felt totally different.
People ask this all the time, as you look at it retrospectively, what was special or different about Brooklyn?
About Brooklyn?
Yeah.
Well, I think what people are missing now, to a large degree, is the sense of neighborhood. The sense of, you know, people hanging out their windows and sitting on the stoops. And there was no air conditioning. We used to wet down the sheets to sleep at night. And everybody looked out for everybody else's child.
Right.
And
your neighbor was always your neighbor. Nobody
yeah,
moved.
Even if they were the ones you hated, the ones you liked, and the gossip was around.
You gathered on the corner.
Yeah.
You played
the candy
games.
Store. You played in the candy store. I played in the street. This game, Skelly, you know, where you filled. You remember that? You filled bottle tops with wax and you shoot.
Call ring Alivio 1-2-3, and he
went
around my base.
Yeah. Every time the cars came down the street, you had to get out of the way.
Is that gone? Have we changed?
I think yeah. In a way, that's what's missing now. This sense of community and. I mean, look what's happening in the inner cities and all this crime. I don't think we had that kind of crime in those days, do you?
And you're obviously, as an activist, upset with the way we're dealing with it, right? I mean, would you describe yourself as angry?
I'm very upset. That's one of the reasons I came on your show. Even though I didn't want to come on, Larry, I said, well, you know, what purpose could I serve? And I'm really... You see, I'm very grateful to be an American. I feel very patriotic. Every time I go out of the country, I can't wait to come back home. And what I'm tired of, what is bothering me, is this anti-government rhetoric that is so is around here. And
we hate the institutions. We hate the government.
The government was very good to me. The government put me into that school. The government paid for my schooling at Erasmus Hall High School. The government gave me art classes and music classes where I was inspired. You know, when I heard the girls' chorus sing, and later on in 1966, I made a Christmas album where I tried to recreate the sound of that girls' choir, you know? And that's what's being taken away from children now. They're not having the same opportunities that we had as kids.
When we come back, we'll talk about why it used to be angry at policy. In the 60s, people were angry at Vietnam, but now we seem to be angry at everything. We'll talk about that in a minute. Our guest, Barbra Streisand. This is Larry King Live. We'll be right back. Barbra Streisand's here tomorrow night. I know you're both fans of her. You like her speaking out on politics, by the way?
I think she's, just as if we have a right to speak out on entertainment, I think she has a right to speak out on politics. I think she should do it.
Larry King Live 10th Anniversary is brought to you by Plymouth Neon. Say hello to the frisky new Plymouth Neon Sport Coupe. And by Carrier. For affordable, energy-efficient comfort systems, call your local Carrier dealer today.
We're back on this special edition of Larry King Live during our 10th Anniversary week. We thank Barbra Streisand very much for being with us. Well, what do you make of this?
Well,
this anger at everything.
I think people are against the idea of government, because this rhetoric gets to you, you know? It sparks anger. Anger sparks anger. You know, hate is a great energizer.
It's big and it's bad.
It's not good. But it's like, I think that we all take the government for granted, you know? I mean, the government pays for the highways you drive on, the parks that you stroll in, the libraries you borrow your books from. You count on the government to protect your pension funds, your savings deposits. You count on the government to protect you against dirty, you know, impure water.
Land you safely.
Against the air you breathe. Against drugs, I was watching a program on thalidomide, which is now coming back on the market, but it must never be used for pregnant women. The Food and Drug Administration Act kept it out of this country while 10,000 babies were born deformed in other parts of the world.
So you think the anger is geared at what then? What are we angry? Why? How can the anger appeal to us?
Because I think everybody has the propensity to be angry. I mean, I fight it. I fight my negativity. I try to be positive where my instinct is perhaps to be negative. And these are hard times. I mean, I'm very angry at what this Republican Congress is trying to do to people. And I really wonder if people know what's being done to them. You know, like Harry Truman in 1948 said, how many times do people have to get hit over the head before they realize who's hitting them? I don't know if people are reading the papers enough, or they just listen to these 10-second sound bites on television that really don't explain.
But they're not evil. The Republicans aren't evil. They see the philosophy is different from yours, don't they?
Yeah, it's a very different philosophy, and I think that I guess they believe in this Reaganomics or trickle-down economics. It doesn't make any sense to me. We tried that in the 80s. We tripled the debt.
You benefit from it.
I, as a rich person.
Right? As a rich person.
Yeah. But does it make any common sense? I mean, to you, does it make sense to you, like now, the things that they're proposing, to give tax cuts to the rich, to give tax cuts to me? I don't need them. I'd rather my money go to feed, kids in school. I'd rather my money go to pay for education, for Health Start, for Goals 2000, to give kids student aid, college loans. Have it to pay for research and science, technology,
do you
medicine.
People don't agree with that? People don't want to help kids go to school, help kids grow up healthy, and feed them at school lunches, and
I think that
get them out of poverty?
I think that because of their different ideology and this belief that the rich will trickle down this wealth to the more ordinary American, they believe in catering to big corporations and big business and the wealthy people. I just don't believe in this philosophy. I believe you have to. I believe we're paying the price, by the way, of Reagan's cutting those social programs in the 80s, and the more crime in the streets, the erosion of the family. We need more prevention programs, more rehabilitation programs. We've lost faith in people. We have to educate these people. We have to give them jobs. Then there'll be less crime. Do you know that the only people whose incomes have gone up in the last few years are college graduates? People need education. Drive-by shootings are not committed by college graduates.
Why do you think, though, they come down so hard on you? Other people have those opinions. They're debated.
As
an individual, Barbra Streisand, the other day, Bob Dole said, I quoted this to the president last night, if President Clinton needs $1 million, he's got to go to Hollywood to get it, so he's not going to criticize Hollywood. If he needs $2 million, he's going to ask Barbra Streisand to do a concert. And it was a conservative audience. They applauded him. Why you?
Why do I get attacked?
Yeah.
Well, in this case, you're talking about, I'm a woman. I'm an actress. I'm a Jewess. I'm a liberal and proud to be one.
You think it's all those things, including Jewess?
I'm sure.
Do you feel put upon?
Maybe a little bit, but in a sense, who are they going to put it on? I mean, I'm an easy target, like Hollywood is an easy target. You know, Bob Dole talks about Hollywood, and he grabs the headlines he wants. He's running for president. And everybody tunes in when it has to do with Hollywood. It's glamorous. It's
easy to knock.
Very easy to knock, yeah.
You knock in films you don't like, right?
I would say that I am against violence, gratuitous violence in films. I am against degrading lyrics. I'm against all those things.
But what
disturbs me is this blanket denunciation of an entire industry that has wonderful filmmakers and wonderful recording artists that give a lot to the American public and that make films that uplift the spirits and that are life-affirming and give people a lot of joy. So I'm against the hypocrisy, I guess. The hypocrisy in what he says. In other words, if he's against violence, why is he for putting more guns on the streets? Fake guns in the movies don't kill. Real guns in schools and in the streets do kill. He talks about being against casual sex. Well, what about PBS? There's no casual sex and no violence on PBS. Why does he want to abolish it?
Do you think he should also be against Schwarzenegger films and Bruce Willis films?
Of course. He didn't bother to mention those people because, you know, they're a power base for him, for his funding, for his support system. Also, I think this is a very important thing, that I think they're trying to discredit Hollywood as a whole because it is a powerful base for influencing public opinion and raising enormous amounts of money. And I think he's trying to ward off, you know, the president and other Democratic candidates from coming to Hollywood to raise money.
More with Barbra Streisand on this special edition of Larry King Live tomorrow night. Barbara Walters, Ted Turner, Tom Brokaw, and Mike Wallace. Thursday night, King Hussein and Yitzhak Rabin and Yasser Arafat. Friday night, David Letterman. Saturday night, Clint Eastwood. We'll be right back.
Everybody says, don't tell me not to live, just sit and fun. Life's candy and the sun to fall upon. Don't bring around a cloud to rain on my parade.
We're back. Barbara, by the way, is an inveterate note taker. She has thousands of notes prepared for months for this appearance after taking 6 months to agree to it, and even wears glasses to read the notes. You look beautiful in glasses. Show the public what you really are. You're a normal human being.
I am a normal human being with extraordinary talent. Thank you.
By the way, I mentioned Mike Wallace here tomorrow night. Is that over, or you still have a little grudge over his anger at you, or the way he treated, or things he said about you?
Well, as when I asked him afterwards, why were you so cruel to me? He said, well, you wouldn't want me to do another show like Barbara Walters did, you know, where she's so nice to you and everything. Probably thinks you're too nice to me, too.
I just ask questions. I don't know about nice or not nice. I'm just curious.
You're a nice person.
But he is not a nice person?
I think he has a bit of a mean streak, sad to say.
Philosophically.
I don't know about his philosophy, but it was interesting because the day after the show, he wanted to know what I thought of it, and I was in shock, in a sense. Although, as a director, I could appreciate the theatrics of it. You know, there were moments caught that were very real. And so I said I would have to think about it. I didn't like it, but I could appreciate the drama, you know? And so the next week, the thing that really offended me was the week after the show, he had some letters that said he was very mean to me and so forth. And he said, well, I talked to Barbara and she really liked it. And then I felt like I was date raped.
Really?
Yeah, that was a violation of what I said to him.
There's a lot of cynicism about you and you toward the press, isn't there?
Yeah, well, I don't understand it because I don't think I'm cynical. So, you know, when I went to Washington a couple of years ago, I had never been to Washington as a tourist. And I read articles that didn't believe that. They didn't believe it. Now, that's like somebody saying, you know, I know your cousin in the Bronx, and I say, I have no cousins in the Bronx. And they say, no, you know, the cousin, I know. I say, believe me, I don't have... These people would not believe I was a tourist. I had never been to the Smithsonian, to the Library of Congress, to Monticello, Thomas Jefferson's house that inspired my set for the tour. I had never been to the National Archives. I was never, a long time, when I was a kid, I was never interested in American history. So you know, I got interested over the years, and now, I mean, to look at the Monroe Doctrine, to see the George Washington's inaugural address, it was thrilling to me.
And the press did what?
Made fun of it, as if I had some other political ambitions. And as I've said before, you know, they confuse my political passion with my political ambition. I am not running for any office.
No desire to ever.
No, and even the New York Post, you know, called me up one day after I made a speech at the APLA against, it was the Reagan administration and his attitude towards AIDS. You know, people thought I was going to run for a Senate seat. They called me up. I said, I'm absolutely not running. And the next day, front page of the New York Post, you know, Senator Streisand. So what disturbs me is that people do not check the facts anymore. They use the traditional, legitimate journals today, use the gossip columns and rag sheets as sources of information.
We're in a crazy, turbulent time.
I'm in shock over this. I mean, it is funny, you know, and part of it is funny because I'll turn on the television, I'll hear, Barbra Streisand's in a feud with Kathy Lee Gifford. And I go, really? What? What's it about? You know, stay tuned at 11. News at 11. I have to stay tuned to find out what this feud is about, right? And it's nonsense. It is made up out of whole cloth. It's just not true. I open the LA Times, and there is in the column, I'm in a feud with Madonna. Well, what was this one about? You know, I can see sometimes where the sources of the story come from.
Do you think you'd ever like to own a media outlet?
Yeah.
Like television?
I was talking to Kay Graham the other day. We had lunch together. And? I think that would be fantastic.
What do you want to buy?
What's for sale?
I mean, would you buy a newspaper, television station?
Yeah, a newspaper. That would be the greatest. Yeah, because look at Rupert Murdoch's New York Post. You know, they say that Barbra Streisand from the left coast. I mean, that's nonsense. You know, they make up these stories every other day. There's a terrible story
about
me.
So you can get your own voice back?
Well, that's one of the reasons I did your show, Larry.
No, and beyond that, you want to maybe buy into a TV?
I don't think I have enough money, but maybe if I save up and do another concert tour.
You did all right with that, huh? Yeah, we
yes,
got you started on that. No finance
fee. You did.
Fee,
that's
nothing.
Right. That's
I
right.
Did.
You did. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We'll be right back. We'll be back with Barbra Streisand, who, if she stays with it, is going to make it. Don't go away.
Why settle for?
One of Larry's favorite moments.
Did you ever do the affectations that all the imitators did of you?
Not that I know of.
Because I know someone said that Cary Grant never said Judy, 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 ever.
No, he never did.
And you were there
doing this. I never said pizza, pizza, pizza.
It's one of Larry's favorite moments.
We're back with Barbra Streisand. Let's take up some current issues. There's a knock against supporting the arts, the Endowment for the Arts. They'd like to reduce the funding for that. Mm-hmm. What do you make of that?
Well, I think it's terrible. I think it's really terrible. You know, this again, these lies, the myths that get perpetrated by constant perpetuation of the fiction, you know?
Well, they say, why should we support artists?
You see, first of all, their reason is that we have to, you know, cut spending. So the first thing to go is the arts. Now, is this nonsense? There's a $1.5 trillion budget. The arts, the NEA budget, is 1/9,000th of the budget, 0.003% of the budget. The NEA budget is equal to one F-22 fighter jet. And the government is planning a jet that we don't even need because it was going to be used to fight in the Cold War. The government's going to make 442 of these planes. That's 70-some billion dollars. One less plane, we have the entire NEA budget. It's equal to one C-17 wing. The wing of a C-17 plane, it's equal to 5 hours of defense spending. And let's talk about what it brings to people. Culture, education, joy. It's the opposite of elitism, because the so-called rich people, the elitists, can come to New York and go to the Philharmonic and go to the theater and go to dance. And they don't need it. But people who make $40,000 and less, people who can't afford cable, you know, that's what these programs do. They bring regional theater. They maintain American traditional arts and crafts, sewing centers, quilting, dance troupes. You know,
Christopher Reeve, by the way, was very big in that fight.
Yes, I was very, very saddened by what happened.
Do you know him?
No, I didn't know him personally, but I know he was speaking out for the NEA, and it's just a very sad thing that shows you have to live life in the moment and get the most out of it.
Mr. Gingrich is in New Hampshire this weekend. Do you think he might run for president? We discussed it last night.
I have a feeling that he will. He's going to probably want to take advantage of his momentum.
Does that scare you?
Very much.
Because?
Because I don't think you can believe anything he says. I think he says one thing and does another. He speaks out of both sides of his mouth. So he makes this incredible speech, you know, that we all think, God, this man is kind of bipartisan attitude. You know, he has a bipartisan attitude. He talks about the attributes of the greatest president, Franklin Delano Roosevelt.
Of his lifetime.
And then he goes about trying to dismantle every policy that Franklin Delano Roosevelt stood for. So, no, I don't understand giving tax cuts to the rich at the expense of the elderly, the poor, the disabled, the children. No, I don't understand that.
Are you going to be active in the Clinton campaign?
Well, as active as I can be. I mean, I'm going to go back to making movies. And
You're a fundraiser, right? I mean,
yes.
Put on concerts. Will you do that in the 96
camp? If I'm asked to.
If asked, you will.
Yeah.
By the way, I know you've been in New York a while, and you've always lived in New York, right?
Oh, yeah, I've lived here for 32 years.
So even though you
I've
had
lived
the
here
home,
actually more than that, but I've...
The home in L.A. were always other homes,
uh-huh.
Right? You've always kept the New York residence.
Yes.
Vote in California, though.
Yeah.
Okay. On that New York concept, and people ask, mm-hmm. what movie are you making here?
I'm making two movies here.
At the same time?
No.
No. Which first?
If I could, I would. The first one is The Mirror Has Two Faces. It's because I couldn't raise the money for my other film called The Normal Heart, which is about...
AIDS.
And one of the things I feel passionate about is raising money for AIDS. And
you couldn't raise money for The Normal Heart?
I couldn't raise enough money for this movie, and I couldn't get certain actors to commit in this time period, so it's going to have to wait till next April.
But you are going to do it?
Yes.
So what's the other one?
The other one is called The Mirror Has Two Faces. And
which is about...
It's about the illusion of beauty. It's about vanity, and it's about the exterior versus the interior, and what makes people fall in love and relationships.
Original script?
Yeah, it's by Richard LeGravenaise, who just wrote The Bridges of Madison County.
Did you see that film?
Not yet. Can't wait to.
Do you like him as a writer?
Very much.
Because you're a writer.
He wrote The Fisher King.
Yeah, you wrote Yentl.
That's right.
Do you, are you going to direct this?
I think so, yeah.
And star in it?
I think so.
Anyone else named yet?
Jeff Bridges. My co-star.
And that star, are you shooting in Brooklyn?
No.
Why not, Barbra? Why not come home all the way?
I'm not going to shoot it because I play a Columbia professor, and he plays a Columbia math professor, and I'm a mythology teacher of romantic literature.
When do you start shooting?
I start pre-production in July and start shooting in October.
Is that a nervous period for you? You're nervous about... You have stage fright.
When I'm behind the cameras, I'm not nervous.
At all?
Not usually. Maybe the first few days of shooting.
Because you're in control?
Make sure your head is blocking your hand.
Yeah.
Are you...
Not me.
I'm fussy.
Fussy?
I mean...
Of course.
Really?
Really.
Because we're all shocked at that.
Oh, yes, I'm sure.
No, but I mean, are you particular about every little thing when you're in a film?
I think excellence is in the details.
So it's important to you how... That nail looks
exactly
in that wall.
Exactly. Yes, that's right. When I was doing Yentl, I was, I was putting the different colored fruits to match each scene and what the people wear as the backgrounds next to them. And I wanted the actors and actresses to have beautiful underwear. So even though the audience doesn't see it, they feel it, a sense of the period,
sense of originality. Said in an interview that we're going to air Saturday, mm-hmm. concerned that there's no small part. Every part mm-hmm. in a film
yeah.
is important.
That's
you
true.
Never throw away something. You don't say, okay, we'll cast him.
Oh, no, right. No, no. Everything's important.
We'll be right back with Barbra Streisand, whose theme could be Everything is Important. We'll be right back. Don't go away.
No way to stop, no way to go back. Snowball that gathering speed down the hill.
By the way, I mentioned Barbara, the note taker. What is this? No. I mean, what is this? This pad and the glass. What is this?
I write a lot.
You like writing better than anything else, right?
Yeah, I like it better than talking, I'll tell you that. Yeah.
So read something you wrote. Just here. Take something out of the journal. Read it.
All right.
Like, this is all in preparation for this. This is the journal for Larry King Live.
Well, these are thoughts that
thoughts.
I have. Yeah, okay. This says, well, if I came to D.C. to say we need a trade war with China because they're ripping off my CDs and movies, everybody would say, good for her, she's a businesswoman looking out for her own interests. But somehow it's hard for some people to conceive of the fact that I'm interested in money for AIDS research, or that I care about children and education or the environment. It seems that it can't be processed if there's no self-interest, except that the self-interest is that it makes me feel good.
So in other words, do you think that has to do with being a woman as well?
I think that what happens is that there is a need to discredit the accomplishments of strong, competent women. I think the society isn't quite ready for her. You know, she's still a threatening figure in our culture.
So we have to put her down some way.
Yeah.
And despite all your accomplishments, mm-hmm. you feel that. I mean, there's nothing in your chosen profession you haven't won. Right? Tony, Oscar,
mm-hmm.
Grammy, Emmy, everything.
Mm-hmm.
They've accorded to you. What's your complaint?
Oh, it's funny. I mean, it's kind of funny.
Are they important to you?
To win the awards?
Yeah.
I like winning the awards, sure. I mean, I don't remember awards that I've won as a child, by the way. As a kid, like Quincy says to me, you know, we won the Grammy, your first Grammys together. I have no recollection of it. Or I'll read this booklet that we were preparing for one of these retrospective albums, and I say, oh, I won that award, the Drama Critics Award. I have no recollection of it.
Really?
So, awards never used to mean anything to me. Today, I guess being acknowledged as a good director would mean something to me.
The movies you make and the things you get involved in, do they have more now of a social statement about you?
I think they do, because it's really hard to go to work every day, and it's a hard job directing a movie. And you have to really love it.
How about when you don't have need? You have no financial need. In other words, you could retire.
Mm-hmm.
So what drives you?
To be a better person, I mean, after many years of therapy, you know, I still don't understand myself in many areas. I make crazy decisions. I react. Well, even the stage fright is a strange reaction that I wish I could understand and figure out, you know. I wish I could have more peace in my life. I wish I could get less angry. I wish I could transcend certain feelings.
When you were a kid and you thought of fame and you were going to make it, and you had a lot of faith that you were going to make it, and you knew you were good, is it all it's cracked up to be?
It wasn't what it was cracked up to be. I mean, I was a child escaping my reality. So I went to the movies every Saturday and dreamed that I was Scarlett O'Hara. You see, not the actress playing in the movie, but the character of Scarlett O'Hara, let's say. That was before my time, by the way, that movie. But movies like that, you know, where
you wanted
girl,
to be her.
I wanted to be the character in the play. And then with fame, I'm a work-oriented person, you know. I enjoy the work and the creative process. So I don't enjoy the glamour part. I don't enjoy opening nights or big parties or photographers or interviews. I don't enjoy that.
Obviously.
Yeah.
You're enjoying this, though. You're having a good time.
I wouldn't go so far as saying I'm enjoying it, but it's not, like, destroying me.
Would you say you are a person who probably will never be satisfied?
I don't want to be that person. I mean, I probably think you're right, but I would be striving to come to into more harmony with myself than that, to really appreciate myself. That's hard.
Is a relationship, you say this next movie's about relationships, mm-hmm. is that important to you? Do you want a remaining life relationship?
Very, very important. I mean, you know, there's this weekend I heard somebody quote a Sufi poet, Rumi, who said, life without love and passion is a life not worth having lived. And,
but you've had love and passion.
Yes,
right?
I've had.
And you want
love
it again?
And passion. Of course.
And you want to spend your life with someone.
Who said that? Freud? Love and work?
Yeah.
That's what it's about.
But you, that's a goal.
Absolutely. I want a partner. I want the masculine to my feminine and the feminine to my masculine.
Do you think, though, and you're very honest about mm-hmm. yourself, you'd be awfully hard for someone? It would take an extraordinarily strong person.
Well, that's what I'm looking for.
But don't you think, when you think of that, that this guy, there ain't a lot of these kinds of guys.
You're probably right. But I'm also, you know, a little girl. I'm also a weak child. I'm many things. If somebody wants, you know, many women in his life, then I'm the person.
And you think you can be 50-50?
Oh, definitely.
Because you're a control person.
Yeah, but I'm working on that. That's something one tries to grow out of, you know, to surrender, to compromise, to... I do believe in giving in to what the universe is presenting, you know, to be spontaneous, to go with the wind, to compromise, you know? So there's much to learn about in life.
Do you feel your age?
No.
You feel much younger? How old are you inside? How old is Barbra Streisand?
Well, at times I'm about 18, 4... and maybe about 38.
You think about how you look, though, but you're not a plastic surgeon person, right?
I would be scared out of my wits. I don't even have pierced ears.
I know the feeling. I know where you're from.
You know?
In Brooklyn.
I wouldn't let anybody put a gun in my ear and shoot that hole into my ear. So I have these screwbacks, you know?
We'll be back with some more moments with Barbra Streisand. Don't go away.
Thing makes me sick.
The way you're reacting makes me sick.
Why do you expect me to react, huh? What if I'd done the same thing to your son?
It's not the same thing.
Now change your name and turn you into a Presbyterian quarterback.
It's quite different, Mr. Wingo. My son didn't try to kill himself.
Oh, give him time, Lowenstein. Give him time.
You son of a bitch. Oh. 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 God, I'll get you some ice. Oh, jeez.
Oh, I see a big malpractice suit coming out of this, doctor.
I am so embarrassed.
How's your son?
He's great.
How old is he now?
28.
Is he going to continue with an acting career?
I hope so. He was
terrific in Prince of
Wasn't
Colin.
He wonderful?
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought so, too.
Does he retain a close relationship with his father, with Elliot mm-hmm. Gould, and mm-hmm. so that family part stays well?
Oh, yeah, I spoke to his father this morning.
Is that one of the proudest things to raise a successful
yeah.
child?
Yeah, who is kind and considerate and talented and sensitive and handsome, and he's wonderful. He's just wonderful. I'm very proud of him.
We're at the Plaza Hotel doing this program. You were here when you did The Way We Were, right?
Yes.
Is that one of your favorites?
Yeah. I had a wonderful time making that movie.
Because of Redford?
I loved working with him. I loved working with Sidney Pollack. I loved the script. I loved the story. It's a wonderful story.
Any movie you made you regret?
What a terrible thing to ask me.
Any?
Yeah, there are several movies I regret, but then don't I hurt the filmmakers and
yeah.
people?
Yeah, but there are some. Mm-hmm. Ever turned down a part you regret?
Several. Mm-hmm.
Like?
Julia.
The part that went to?
Jane Fonda. I actually said I I've turned down a couple of three movies that she that made her very famous. But good for Jane, you know, I'm glad that it was They Shoot Horses and Julia and Clute.
You turned down Clute? Why?
Because at certain times I don't like working. I turned down directing Shadowlands, which I loved, but I just didn't feel like working.
How do you relax?
I like to
walk
on the... I have
difficulty with that question.
Yeah, yeah. It's actually hard for me to relax, but then when I get into that relaxation mood, I tell you the truth, I love to go on boats. Boats soothe me, you know, they rock me to sleep.
Sailboats, motorboats, all kinds of boats.
Sailboats, yeah, motorboats. My best vacations are on boats. And I love to read. I read an awful lot. I never play music, and I don't like sports.
And were you happy with your tour?
I was.
You were so queasy about it.
I know, but it was very satisfying to interact with the people, you know, the people who have supported me for 30-some years. And it warmed my heart. It was a wonderful experience.
You mean you're going to do it again?
I don't know if I would do it again. I'm not sure about that.
Isn't it a hoot? I don't know how to ask this. Isn't it a hoot to sing when you can sing as well as you sing? I mean, I would guess that if I could sing like that,
oh,
I'd
want
to sing all the
time. People say that to me, but you know...
I'm a bell.
You're a bell?
No, I would think I'm a bell. I would love to hear just the sound of it.
At moments, I've appreciated the sound of my voice. But most of the time, unfortunately, I take it for granted, too.
It for granted.
Most of the time, and I must never do that because it's a God-given gift, and I don't want to ever take it for granted.
Would you ever come back to the Broadway stage?
No.
Because?
Oh, frighten the
people again.
My God, no.
Stage fright?
Yeah.
Or boredom?
I get frightened when I go to sit in the theater to watch a play. You know, so can you imagine me on the stage?
When we see you coming out of a building and you run into a limousine and they yell, there's Barbra Streisand, or she's having dinner in Washington and people follow her around, that's a shyness about you, right? You're not aloof.
I know, I'm not aloof.
You're the opposite of aloof.
I don't like to be watched. I don't like to be photographed. You know, I feel like the Africans, that something of my soul is taken away in the photograph. I just don't enjoy that part of it.
Do you think you can win, your side can come back? Are the liberals going to come back?
Gosh, I hope so. I don't believe how people are shying away from being associated with that wonderful word. You know, I mean...
You're proud to be a liberal.
Very, very, very proud. Liberals, as I said in my Harvard speech, they fought slavery. They fought for women to have the right to vote. They fought apartheid, segregation. They fought against Hitler, Stalin. They brought in the minimum wage. They fought against child labor laws. They made education possible, Medicare, Medicaid, unemployment insurance, which I took part in. You know, I used the government to take
unemployment
insurance. Yeah, after I was a switchboard operator and a clerk. You know, they fired me because the companies merged and they let me go.
So you got unemployment?
I got unemployment.
From New York State?
Yes.
Today,
absolutely.
Before we leave, today is the birthday of Virginia Kelly, who you got to be friends with.
I told you that.
That's right.
Because you wouldn't have known that.
I would not have known
That's
it. And
right.
The president didn't mention it last night. Well,
today is her birthday.
Who was she like? I met her a few times. She was terrific. When I saw her, she was fun-loving.
She knew how to live. She knew how to enjoy life. She just, you know, she squeezed every bit of it dry, you know. And
you formed a breast cancer foundation in her name?
Yeah, I did.
At the University of Arkansas?
That's right. I think breast cancer is a terrible disease, and more money has to go into research for it and into the environmental research about pesticides, which they're finding out can cause breast cancer.
And that's in her name?
In her name, because she was this delicious person who was so kind to me and so good to me and so supportive of me when I had to go sing for my first two nights back after 27 years, and she came to hear me both nights.
We're out of time. How's your health?
Fine, thank you.
Have you ever had bad health?
Bad health?
Yeah, have you ever had a major physical problem?
Except for a cesarean birth. No.
My never hospitalized?
No, thank God. Where's Wood? Yeah, right.
Bye, darling.
Goodbye.
Now, is it okay? Are you happy?
I'm happy.
Barbra Streisand, thanks for joining us. Thank you. Good night. Hank could mess up her hair.
And now this song is for my son, Jason. Nothing's gonna harm you, not while I